Beaton with a one-inch advantage. Barrera, unusually long arms, as so many great fighters do have. 2.5 inches longer from armpit to the end of the fist than those of Beaton. They both weighed in right on the 130-pound limit. And look, astonishing. Marco Antonio Barrera has put on, unofficially, no weight overnight. Robbie Beaton has unofficially followed what is the norm for modern boxers, putting on 13 pounds in mostly rehydration from 130 up to unofficially 143. When this happened in Barrera's third fight with Eric Morales, and Morales entered the ring with a 13-pound weight advantage, we all immediately assumed that it would be an edge for Morales. Instead, Barrera stepped inside, outquicked him, and outfought him at close range to win the fight. Rules of the bout with our in the ring. An Australian Aboriginal performer is providing folk music with an Australian instrument, as you can see there. It's an amazing spectacle, mesmerizes the crowd here at ringside, and all of that attends the entrance into the ring of Robbie Beaton.
There have been two other title holders from Australia who were Aborigines. Lionel Rose, a bantamweight of many years ago, and the current super middleweight, Anthony Mundine.
And Beaton, like Mundine, is half of British descent and half of Aboriginal descent. Incidentally, the Aboriginal instrument that's being used in the ring is called a didgeridoo. And you probably saw didgeridoos when you watched the 2000 Sydney Olympics on American television. So here's the reemergence of that tribal instrument. Beaton's first win over Nate Campbell. Fifth round KO took place when Campbell foolishly dropped his arms and challenged Beaton to hit him in the middle of the ring. Beaton did and knocked him out. That Marco Antonio Barrera is that ultra-rare fighter who trains himself to an absolute perfect pitch at that weight and stays there.
Yeah,
it doesn't happen.
And also, listen, he's been probably eating and working hard just to make the 130. I really believe he was way below that, even. He was an extra effort to make 130. And he just didn't feel like doing anything else after that.
Well, with all the 130-pounders moving up to 135, Barrera may have the opportunity to do so now, Larry, if he wants to fight Jesus Chavez, who won the first fight on the card this evening.
If he's going to come in at 130 against Jesus Chavez,
he better wear some body armor, right?
Yeah.
He better wear a flak jacket.
Well, that probably work out a deal where even though it's a 135-pound title, they probably come in at 132 would probably be the max.
Get ready for the fight, undergoing surgery for hematoma on the brain at a nearby hospital. Our good friend and his promoter, Lou DiBella, is filing reports for us from the hospital. We'll keep you posted as we gain more information. Now let's go to ring announcer Michael Buffer to settle this fight.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the MGM Grand of Las Vegas, Nevada, USA, Golden Boy Promotions is proud to present the main event of the evening. 12 rounds of boxing, a unification contest for the WBC IBF Super Featherweight Championship of the World. Brought to you in association with HBO Pay-Per-View and the MGM Grand, and presented in association with Goose and Tudor Promotions, sponsored by Ice Link Watches and Remy Martin, sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission Chairman Skip Avancino Jr., Executive Director Mark Ratner. The three judges at ringside scoring this bout on the 10-point system will be John Keane, Dave Moretti, and Michael Pernick. And when the bell rings, the referee in charge of the action inside the ring, referee Richard Steele. And now, for the thousands in attendance here at the MGM Grand in Las Vegas, and the millions watching around the world on HBO pay-per-view. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble! Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner, wearing black with silver, official weight, 130 pounds. A two-time Olympian whose professional record now stands at 25 victories, including 14 knockouts with only two defeats. Tonight, he comes to this ring looking to build on the fighting Aboriginal legacy established by the legendary Lionel Rose by giving all he has. Here's the fighting pride of Brisbane, Australia, the reigning, defending, IBF super featherweight champion of the world, Robbie the Bomber Peden. Across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing light blue with white letters, official weight also 130 pounds. His professional record, 60 victories, including 42 knockouts with four defeats, and he has captured six world titles. He's recognized as pound for pound, one of the best fighters in the world today. Damas y caballeros de Ciudad de México, the three-time super bantamweight world champion, two-time featherweight world champion, the reigning, defending WBC super featherweight champion of the world, the baby face assassin, Marco Antonio Barrera.
Yes, sir.
Right here, brother. Alex.
Okay, I spoke to both fighters in the dressing room. I'm cautioning them again. Obey my commands at all times. Shake hands. Good luck.
This isn't sparring. What will the difference be when they fight for real?
Well, sometimes when a football team knows the other team too well, or a basketball team knows the other team too well, you get something that's sloppy and rough-hewn. Let's see if we see technical brilliance here instead.
You know, this is always happening. A lot of times you see a guy who's sparred with a champion, but took it for a while, he has that sparring partner syndrome when he gets in an action match with that guy. It is some sparring sessions, unknown to the public, some of the sparring partners actually have better of some of the champions than the guys who are paying them.
Herrera starting out with the jab from distance, as though he wants to keep Peden out there away from him. Peden steps in and fires a left hand to the body. Robbie Peden fighting with his left down below his waist. And Herrera takes advantage to fire a quick left-hand shot to the middle of the chest. Herrera can attack, or he can counterpunch. Sometimes he can choose, based on whatever you do. Peden misses with the left. Herrera pops him to the body inside.
Herrera is a fighter who moves with a real slow rhythm. He doesn't look like much, but when he executes, whether it's a counterpunch or whatever, much faster, like right there. He punches back at a much faster rate than his regular body movement is.
So hand speed is surprising.
Yes, and that's why he catches opponents so often, because he's moving so slow. And they don't expect it when he punches, just punch at a different speed.
It's interesting, Emmanuel, because it's like a pitcher who has a deceptive motion and the ball busts out of his hand and catches the batter by surprise.
I've always thought that the most vulnerable time for Barrera when is what he's jabbing. He always has that tail like jabbing. He like paws with it, and if someone would really take advantage of him and try to catch him, then he'd make it catch him. But other than that, he's a very, very good, solid fighter.
How important in Barrera's genesis, Larry Merchant, were the two losses to boxer puncher Junior Jones? Did he learn from that that he needed to be a more versatile fighter?
Well, the first fight, he just got caught by a surprise punch from a very good puncher. The second fight, he elected to come out and box him and lost a boxing contest. And later on down the road, he decided that he would emphasize his boxing more and brawl when it was necessary. And he has a very good intuition when to do either. Right now, he thinks he can pick a Payton apart. You almost sense that he knows where Payton is vulnerable at a fight of this pace.
The herky-jerky motion and dancing rhythm of Robbie Payton has not amounted to a great deal in the first round, as Barrera has controlled him with his boxing.
Yes, but I don't know if the fight progresses. I don't know if Barrera's going to be able to control him in the manner that he has did in the past with more standard fighters who just stood stationary in front of him with very little upper body movement.
When we go to Barrera's corner where they speak Spanish, our interpreter is Ray Torres.
Okay. You don't have to go with his fight. You fight your calm fight with your style. Okay, keep jabbing. Yes, nice and easy jabbing. Yeah, don't get overexcited. Don't fight his fight.
You have to be afraid to hit that body either. When you drop that right hand behind that double jab, come right back to the body with a hook. Okay? Got the first round all.
Yep.
Good round.
Nice round, baby.
Robbie Payton's American trainer, Roger Bloodworth, may be familiar to you from his years of work with fighters at main events, a long roster including Andrew Galata and all of the main events stars whom you saw over those years. And he was working with Fernando Vargas, who was a main events fighter, moved to California, spent a lot of time with Vargas there, and recently has been working with Robbie Payton out of his own home in Illinois. As for Barrera, his trainer, Rudy Perez, is one of the quietest and least noticeable trainers in the sport. Normally, when a fighter is as great as Barrera, and it's been around this long, you know his trainer almost as well. He's a household name. Rudy Perez barely says a word in public. CompuBox numbers in one. Barrera, 18 out of 44, to Payton, 7 out of 39. This looks like a night when Marco wants to box.
Yeah, I think he's gonna have problems as this fight progresses. I just don't see him winning this fight very easy in the manner he has in the past. I think Payton's style and tough mental attitude is gonna present a problem for him.
Well, but I think it's Payton who's gonna have to decide. Payton has decided to box him, and so he'll box him if he has to. But if Payton comes in and attacks them, and I think we might see something else.
Well, it seems to me as good a boxer as Payton is, the evidence is there already. He needs more contact.
Yeah, I don't think Payton is that good a boxer. He has good boxing movements, but he don't really land that much, and he does get hit. I just think all of that movement and stuff is just going to get Barrera a little off track and not let him be as effective as he used to be.
Well, what I see is that Barrera is poking him, and not having much of a problem of finding some target, even if it's not a big punch. He's putting the burden of proof on Payton to come to him, I think is what it amounts to.
This looks like the Marco Antonio Barrera of the first six rounds of his second fight with Eric Morales, when he stunned everyone in the house by fighting such a clinical boxing match that Morales fell into the same rhythm and boxed with him until suddenly, in round seven of that fight, they went back to war. War was what typified 30 of their 36 rounds together.
I guess I'm so used to Barrera, I'd love to see him fight. He puts together combinations so beautiful, particularly when he counter punches. He'll let a guy miss and put four, five, six, seven punches together. All very smoothly, but it's very difficult for him to do that to this opponent, even though he's winning the fight.
That's true. Yeah, you don't often see Marco having to carve out a win one punch at a time. And incidentally, that combination landed very well. Payton lands his jab. Barrera steps aside.
But still, even when Payton has been hit, he's been rolling, twisting, and pivoting, taking a lot of the power out of the punch, whereas the other stationary opponents would just bend in there and stand right into the punch.
You saw Robbie Payton roll his head away from the left hook there.
Yeah.
It was a fair round at the end. But you let him set the pace a little bit too much in the beginning, okay? You got to keep your left hand in the mix and walk up to him a little bit.
Yep.
When you start backing up, he gets aggressive, all right? He doesn't want to be aggressive with you. He's trying to catch you with counterpunch. So keep him uneasy with that foot pressure, all right?
You see how you just did? Nice and serenity. That's what you got to do. Take the punches to him and hit him hard. Yeah, and you're gonna hit him.
Combination from Barrera, left to the forehead, right on the jaw. Payton seems a little bit tight to me, Emmanuel. I don't think he's really cut loose yet. Maybe showing too much respect for the guy he sparred with all these years.
Yeah, he seemed to be a little tight, and you could see in the dressing room he was warming up about twice as long as Barrera was. I get confused sometimes. I say Barrera, and I'm looking at the back of his truck, so I'm saying Tapia.
Well, that's because his mother's name was Tapia. Yeah. And incidentally, of course, Barrera fought Tapia, and that was a confusing night, and they both had the word Tapia on their trunks in the ring. Through round two, 24 Barrera's 34 connects are jabs. He's thrown 67 of them, and 24 out of 67 in jabs in two rounds means you're boxing, and you're boxing effectively, at least offensively. Now Peden lands a little right hand, grabs Barrera, and Barrera pumps him with two lefts inside. Larry made the point about respect, and Roger Bloodworth seemed to be saying the same thing to Robbie Peden between rounds when he said, you're letting him set the pace too much.
Now, how heavy would gloves be in sparring, Emmanuel, as compared to the gloves tonight?
They are actually fighting in 8-ounce gloves, which is what you have to fight in up until junior middleweight. And when they're sparring, they're usually using 16-ounce gloves, sometimes, in other words, twice the amount of weight. Plus, you got head gears and things that's involved, too, just to affect a lot of the effect of the blows.
Marco Antonio Barrera has been very accurate with his jab and his right hand.
Three straight right hands by Barrera.
Landing more or less at will here in round three.
Now he's getting himself together, mainly because Peden is said there's more of a stationary target.
Peden with a little left hook to the body, tries twice upstairs. Barrera blocks the shots. Marco has been way more accurate than Robbie in the early going.
I think he's having a beautiful fight round at this stage. He's getting his range now and getting set where he can start putting more punches than one together.
Look at him snap Peden's head back with a jab and then easily step away from the roundhouse right that came back.
Peden's nervous energy in the beginning seems to have drained a lot of energy out of him.
Barrera keeps his hands up. Peden has his hands down. That alone is enough to make it easier for Marco to land his punches. Now there's a straight right hand over the top for Peden. But look at the right hands.
That's what I like.
Four right hands land in a row. And three solid left hooks. And still Peden's hands are down around his waist.
But unlike a lot of Antonio's opponents in the beginning, in the earlier other fights, he's rolling a lot of his punches too.
But as for scoring, Marco Antonio Barrera is piling up points in a round like that.
I think he's hurting him, too.
Giving away 13 pounds as this fight started.
You're letting him back you around the ring and lets him look like he wins the fight. And then when you get lazy, he jumps on you with two or three punches. You're not rolling under the counter. So you've got to take the offense, all right? Take the offense. Back him up and put him in a war. You're bigger and stronger. Let's make it work.
You got to work him with lateral movements, nice and smooth, with your jab. Okay.
Just see how poised and relaxed Barrera is as he works. Three chopping right hands.
Very accurate puncher.
Harold Letterman, how do you have it through three rounds?
Okay, Jim. 3-0
30-27, Marco Antonio Barrera. Jim, you gotta love that right hand. At least I do. You know, Robbie Peaton's got that left hand all the way down. Number one, all you can do with that left hand down there is throw an up jab. And when you're throwing up jab, you certainly don't get the snap of the power into it. And not only that, you leave your jaw wide open for Barrera to nail you with a lead right hand, which happened in round three. 3-0, Barrera.
Fighter who holds his left hand down like that is generally trying to invite the right hand to counter it with something, but I don't see that Peden has been able to do that yet.
Barrera got something in his eye and was momentarily distracted. And now there's blood flowing from just outside the left eye of Marco Antonio Barrera. So now Barrera has been cut. And that could give Robbie Peden some new confidence. I'm being told it was a headbutt which caused the cut. Barrera's facial expression never changed.
No.
Roger Bloodworth told Robbie Peden to go out and be the aggressor in this round, and Peden has tried. Now Barrera must deal with the distraction of blood outside his left eye.
Is that blood coming into his eye, Emmanuel? Can you tell?
I don't think it is yet, but I can't really tell yet too much. But this is Peden's best round so far. But he still is easy to get hit. His head beats up. He fights in a very good style. It's very difficult for Barrera to fight, but still he doesn't have the best defense himself.
But he seized the aggressor role. And
yes,
he seems
did.
To have,
yes.
have put Barrera back on his heels a little bit. In this round, Marco isn't throwing as many punches and is getting hit a lot more often.
Yeah, once he saw the blood, it really stimulated him, whereas a lot of guys, it doesn't sometimes.
Yeah, Peden seems to have risen up seeing the blood there on Barrera's face. He's landed a couple of really good body shots.
And he's having a good round.
Little left hook by Barrera. Peden steps beyond that one. Good left hook inside by Robbie Peden. Barrera backs him up with three more jabs and whips a right hand onto Peden's face. But all in all, Robbie Peden had his best round of the fight so far.
Yeah, it's going to give a lot more confidence to Peden when he gets back to his corner, I think, after that round. But Barrera didn't do too much, neither, after he got cut. He was seemed to be pretty much concentrating on that cut.
Don't get back on the way to the ropes. Do it just like you did there, right in a circle. Now, when you turn him this way, I want you to step up and throw a two or three punch combination. Take it.
Okay, we just got to go and use our boxing to score points. That's all we have to do, score points.
The Nevada State Athletic Commission says that the cut was caused by a punch. Our video replay seems to suggest that the cut was caused by a butt. In fact, this one seems pretty clear on video replay. This is an area in which we're all fallible, and certainly the replay is a great advantage, and of course, the commission doesn't have it because they don't have a monitor. And incidentally, I've been saying for years, Emmanuel, that I think judges should have a monitor so that they can get an alternative view while they're scoring the fight.
I think they definitely do have it in other sports.
This is the only sport in which you have the electronic enhancement and don't use it to amplify referees' decisions.
And some of those decisions can be crucial.
I'm not sure what you're saying, Jim. You mean
I'm
the
saying
judges
that all
themselves?
The judges should have a monitor sitting next to them, as well as, incidentally, one on the other side of the ring for the commission, so that if our replay shows that this blood was caused by a butt, they can know it.
Well, I get that, but I don't get what good it would do the judges to have. They're watching the fight live.
Yes, but they also tell us that sometimes they are blocked by a fighter whose back is to them along the ropes, or that they're blocked by the referee. And if so, they could look at a monitor for an alternative look.
Only if that whole round was replayed.
No, they could look at the monitor at the moment at which their vision is blocked to get an alternative view. In other words, when their view is blocked, they glance at the monitor and they'll get a different look. That's what announcers do, incidentally. Fifth round of a scheduled 12. Marco Antonio Barrera in the light blue trunks. Robbie Beaton in the black.
Let him go, let him go.
A tactical fight so far.
Yes, and at this stage right now, I'm studying Barrera's mind. I think he's beginning to realize that he's in a very serious fight, and he's taking a whole different attitude about this now. Even though he's always been serious, I think he's more serious now and realize that he could lose this fight even possibly.
Barrera stepping forward into a right hand. Beaton busted him back with a little left hook. Barrera blocking both those punches with his elbows. Now blocking with his gloves. Misses twice with the jab. Beaton able to elude those punches with his head. Easier to hit him to the body. Now Barrera begins to put the stick back on Robbie Beaton.
This is a telling round because Beaton had his best round, the last round, and instead of coming out and being able to build on it, he's been stopped cold.
Big right hand by Barrera.
Yeah, he's putting his punches together.
Good. Hardest punch of the fight.
So if there was a little momentum there, Barrera has reversed it.
Stemmed the tide.
With a lot of confidence, with movements, you're in good condition to go 15 rounds.
Not going to 1-2. It's right there for you. Step up inside. Quit backing out. Step up inside. Go to 1-2. I don't want you worrying about distance or nothing. Let your hands go. You're giving it to him. And when he does, okay. I told you he's going to fire. The only way you're going to stop him from firing those quick counter punches is for you to come again. Okay. You got to throw a 1-2, then come again. Mm-hmm. If you have to throw a 1-2 and rough him up a little bit, then do it. But right now is the time to take it.
Mm-hmm. Roger Bloodworth is not one of those trainers who allows you to cruise through a fight if your opponent is the guy who's winning the round. He's not somebody who sits there and says, everything's fine or the referee's against you. Roger Bloodworth, when Fernando Vargas was in desperate trouble in the last two rounds against Winky Wright, raised his voice and got Vargas to throw 110 punches per round and come back and win the fight.
Just to win a close decision here to do all of that. But, you know, I think that he's telling Peyton, right, but Peyton has got a lot of beautiful defensive upper body movement in terms of being difficult, but he's not that effective because he doesn't punch that much.
What he's telling Beaton is you're going to have to step up inside and throw punches.
Right there. Okay.
What he told him was quit backing out. Meaning that he wants Beaton to go forward all the time. But Barrera says, okay, you come forward, I'll rake you with the right hand. Because as long as Beaton's going to come forward with his left hand below his waist like that, Emmanuel, Barrera can just pop him with the right hand.
Yeah, and he does get hit a lot, but he is a tough guy, though. It's one thing you can't never underestimate having a guy that is physically big, in this case, you're 13 pounds difference, and then mentally very tough.
Beaton showing you the tough guy part of him as he waves Barrera forward.
Barrera is not going to drop his hands and invite him to hit him on the chin.
Now, it's pretty hard to play mind games with Marco Antonio Barrera. Beaton's right hand partially blocked. Barrera does a very good job of getting his gloves on opponent's punches. Beaton lands a little left hook and dances by. Barrera constantly taking small steps.
Break!
Barrera Barrera, a professional ever since age 15.
You know, I give him a lot of credit. He's fighting a very smart fight. You see, he has a very elusive target for big power shots, so he just resorted back to boxing, relax, and then occasionally throwing a power shot. But he's got him relaxed watching the jab now.
16 years as a professional for Barrera, 60 wins. The two losses to Junior Jones, one loss to Eric Morales, and the only night in his career when he was really, truly annihilated, Manny Pacquiao in San Antonio.
Beautiful.
Great right hand by Barrera. He dances and moves side to side, makes it very tough for Peden to find him.
That's what's made him one of the greatest fighters we've had in the last 15, 20 years. He's very diversified. He can do whatever he has to do to win a fight. And this looks like it could be a fight that may be a decision fight. So now he's starting to get into a mode of trying to prepare himself to win this decision if it goes to the limit.
Don't forget your grand conditioning. You got good conditioning, so keep it. Don't let him come and take your conditioning away.
And then when you take a step, take a nice step inside, let your hands go. You're not letting them go.
You're stepping up without punching.
Don't want the power. Go for
nice
speed, you'll get the power.
The good, best defense also.
Yeah.
So like you said, step up, one,
okay,
two.
Here we go.
Step up,
go
one, two.
Speed. You'll get
use
your power.
Use your left hand.
I expected more from Peden.
Barrera's jabbing him to death. CompuBox numbers through six. Barrera landing 13 out of 34 jabs in every round. Peden throwing 29 jabs per round, but landing only two. Harold, how do you have it through six?
You know, Jim, I don't see how Robbie Peden can expect to win his fight with his hands down like that. Because Marco Antonio Barrera just can't miss him with the left jab or with that straight right. Round six, I thought Robbie Peden got a little bit more active, a little bit more busy, at least in the first two rounds, just like you saw there, and did enough to pull it out, even though Barrera had a good last 30 seconds. 58, 56, four rounds to two, Marco Antonio Barrera.
I have it 5-1 for Barrera.
Incidentally, Peden's trainer, Dan Goosen, was proud of his moment at a news conference a couple weeks ago when he unequivocally predicted that Peden would knock Barrera out, not just win the fight, but knock Barrera out. You gotta love Dan. He's a big man who talks big, and he knows how to promote. Straight right hand for Peden. Watching Barrera against the somewhat unconventional Peden, are you reminded of Barrera against the extremely unconventional Prince Nassim Hamed?
You know, I was trying to avoid talking about that. But no, the difference was that this year, Peden has been prepared. He prepared and trained properly for this fight, whereas Hamed didn't. But one thing that is still obvious, the elusive style that Peden has is still a problem for Barrera compared to more of the stationary guys, but Peden doesn't have the punching power of Hamed by no means.
No, did Prince Nassim actually take Barrera lightly, thinking he was simply going to blow him up?
Yes, he did. When I would go into the room where he was training, he was always watching films of Barrera and Junior Jones. He didn't even watch the films of the fights where he had recently where he looked so good. If you remember, before the fight, Barrera's fight just before that, I had even mentioned that I wished that he could get Hamed out of the fight. That's how good Barrera had looked leading into that.
And since the time when Barrera technically dismantled Prince Nassim, Naz has had one more fight and seems basically to have retired from the sport.
Yes, and Barrera's having a very good fight right now, considering the style of this opponent and the toughness and the weight disadvantage.
Once again, Marco Antonio Barrera unofficially entered the ring at 130 pounds, exactly the weight at which he weighed in. You almost never see it. Rob Peden weighed in at 130, came in at 143, unofficially.
Unless you take a chance, you're not winning this fight. Understand what I'm saying? He's the house fighter. You gotta step up and bang. You're not even back. You out of here. Don't make any difference when he hits you. I'm telling you what's going to happen. You're not winning these rounds because you're making him look effective.
The cover's rising too high.
I don't want you to let down now. Just keep going. All confidence. When you throw your hard blows, you'll be sure that it's going to land. Be sure.
Roger Bloodworth said that Peden is making Barrera look effective. I think it's Barrera who's making Barrera look effective.
Exactly. And the notion that Barrera is the house fighter and that makes a big difference is a little bit specious when the fight looks the way that it does. Average per round, CompuBox numbers. Barrera, 21 out of 53. Peden, 7 out of 44. And I think one thing that Bloodworth was saying to Robbie Peden, Emmanuel Stewart, is that he's got to throw more than 44 punches in a round.
His volume of punches, all his body movement and everything, and facial expression is okay, but volume of punches is down.
Well, I think what he's saying is you got to take risks.
And he don't
want to
take.
Peden is a little bit intimidated about taking risks, maybe because of all those rounds he sparred with Barrera, maybe because he knows it doesn't pay.
Well, it's interesting. But we've all heard of the. Go ahead, Larry.
You know, but on this night, when they're doing it for real, you've got to take risks.
Robbie Peden said, with regard to the sparring partner mentality, oh no, I never allowed Barrera to pay me to spar with him. I was doing it for my own advanced education, so therefore there's no sparring partner mentality there. Valid?
That's a true point, and that's probably why he sparred so much with Barrera, because he was the right price.
He was free. Barrera is ripping Robbie Peden along the ropes right now. Sharp combinations, effective body punting with the left hand. The straight right hand upstairs has landed all night. What an accurate puncher Marco is.
I am very impressed with his performance tonight because I knew he was going to have problems with this opponent and his style, and he's made tremendous adjustments as the fight has went on.
And still, Peden doesn't appear to be taking the kind of risk that Roger Bloodworth wanted.
No, in order to attain greatness, and that's where he almost has a tip of fighting a legendary guy like Barrera, you've got to take a chance. If you don't take a chance, you don't have a chance, as far as I'm concerned.
Maybe the evidence in front of him suggests to Peden that if he takes a chance, he might get knocked out.
Yeah, and that could be possible, too. But I just think it's his mindset. And Barrera's not that easy to hit, neither. It's a little strange way of getting away from punches, but he doesn't get hit too often.
Except, of course, when he stands in and trades and goes to war, as he did against Eric Morales in their first and third fights.
That's correct.
He got hit a lot against Morales, but he hit back just as much.
Well, that was just a classic. Two styles that just mesh together to make great fights.
The night that Manny Pacquiao dismantled Marco Antonio Barrera, I thought to myself, that was such a violent wipeout that Barrera should never fight him again. I have completely reversed my opinion about that.
Well, I think that was just a bad night. There's all sports athletes, teams have it, but just in our sport, you don't get a chance to make up for it as quick as the other sporting teams.
Well, Barrera says that Morales just had a bad night last week, and he said, I've had five bad nights, four losses, and the night I got married.
So I guess the divorce was a good night? Maybe not at the right price.
Okay, deep breaths. Let's maintain the same pace. Three or four punches. Well, once in a right, surprise him with a right hand. A hard right. Yeah, with your guard up, nice and careful.
Second chance. The referee's not going to help you. Nobody's going to help you. You can only help yourself. You got four rounds left. You got to keep pressure on him all four rounds, and you got a punch. You need a couple knockdowns. All right, let's go.
Discouraged Robbie Peden, only threw 31 punches in that round, 13 fewer than the round before. Landed only seven. Barrera, 39 out of 79 in what was probably his most brilliant round so far. And this is a Barrera pattern also. He starts out relatively slowly and cranks the tempo up a little bit more each round until eventually the distance between him and you feels like a landslide.
You see, now there was a right hand that Peden threw without any conviction, like from the back seat, and was ducking away as he threw it, as if he was afraid of what might come back if he just stood there and took a chance.
This against a man whom he outweighs unofficially by 13 pounds. But of course, quickness and sharp punching, not necessarily predicated on being bigger and stronger.
Yeah, I think that Peyton does punch with a lot of good speed, but I don't think his hands have much power. His gloves are not closed completely when he punches. Barrera is a much, much more accurate puncher and power puncher.
And some in the crowd would like to see Peyton go to war and make it more entertaining.
Well, he wants to be a champion. He wants to retain his championship or his title. Why isn't he taking some chances?
Even though they're both coming in the ring with championships officially, the public and everyone, including the two of them, consider Barrera as being the champion, really. So he should step it up a little bit.
Come on, man.
Peyton asked Richard Steele to warn Barrera against low blows. Barrera takes the warning, never looks at Steele, keeps hitting Peyton with the right hand. And now Richard Steele warns Robbie Peyton not to hit low, and Peyton didn't feel that Steele had done enough.
Right, and Steele said that was intentional.
Well, actually, any blows that really land on the top band of the cup really isn't really low. I mean, the cups are big. I mean, you're just hitting onto the top of the cup. There's enough of an excuse for you to complain to the referee, but you really don't get hurt with those blows. In fact, you'd rather get hit 30 than actually get hit in the body and in the stomach.
Right.
Round 9 of a scheduled 12 coming to a close. Robbie Peyton has essentially fought the same way for 9 rounds. And as a result, Marco Antonio Barrera has shown off a variety of his wide array of skills.
Great, great. Oh. Oh, come on, come on. Hey, listen, keep it clean.
Barrera's his own police force in there tonight. Yeah.
He's a tough guy, even though he acts quiet and polite, but he can easily be aroused.
There you go on the wall. It's better. But you need every round, you need a knockdown, I'm telling you.
You take this part of the war, son.
This fucking guy is not going to stay with you if you back him up and throw right hands. He's taking advantage of you when you stop and don't do anything. You're walking up, stop.
He's got to keep it clean. I'm telling him the same thing. The next incident, a bomb will be taken. Fuck.
Don't let that SOB bully you. You stand your ground. Be careful with his right hand. Don't let it happen again. Nice.
Why not? It's a fight.
After all.
Keep him up, keep him up.
Well, I mean, Emmanuel Stewart talked about how Marco can be aroused, and of course we all remember the specter of the normally cool Marco Antonio Barrera taking Prince Nassim by the head, running him across the ring and ramming the head into the ring post in the last round of their fight. Harold, how do you have it through 9?
Okay, Jim. 88, 83, 7 rounds to 2. Marco Antonio Barrera. Jimmy's bleeding again from the side of his left eye. And I gotta tell you something. If Peyton opens up that cut in the last 3 rounds and they stop the fight because of that cut, Peyton wins on a TKO. You don't go to the scorecards because Richard Steele called that original cut a punch.
Even though our replays seem to indicate that it was probably the product of a butt. That's one of the toughest things a referee has to do.
One reason, a big reason, that this fight seems to be an easy fight for Barrera, easier than we all anticipated, was that he took Peyton seriously and therefore didn't let him become too serious as a challenger. When
That's a direct comparison, Derek Morales.
Absolutely. When you don't take a fight, an opponent seriously, as I've said on numerous occasions, you can turn him into a serious opponent, no matter what his class is.
Well, one of the words that is most often attached to Barrera is professional, and that ability to be up for every fight is certainly one of the key marks of his professionalism. That, along with the adjustments he's made during his career, the way he's grown as a fighter, the additions he's made to his game, all these things, the mark of great professionalism. Crowd wants to see Robbie Keaton try to make it more of a fight, I guess.
Well, they just want to see a fight, more of a fight. But this is a textbook performance so far by Barrera.
Keaton steps forward with the right hand. Barrera rips him to the left, with the left to the body. And now a point is removed from Marco Antonio Barrera for hitting low.
I'm sorry. How many times had Steele warned him about low blows anywhere along the way?
I believe once.
I think it was once, maybe twice. He might have won both of them.
But he did tell both corners that there would be a point deduction next time.
Yes.
But that to me was a no harm, no foul, slightly low blow.
Well, maybe Richard wanted to be sure things don't get out of hand.
What we call low blows a lot of time are just punches on the top part of the cups, which it shouldn't be called low blows, especially as high as they wear in the cups nowadays.
Let's take a quick look at the low blow for which Marco Antonio Barrera suffered the deduction of a point.
That was right.
On the belt line above the cup.
Yeah.
Just as you said.
I'd rather get hit there than to got hit dead in the solar plexus, which way was angry. That would have been a lot of pain. It's when it comes underneath the cup at the bottom part is where it hurts.
Close your eyes. We got to tighten up things, so put some more pressure. Close your eyes.
You understand what I'm saying? You cannot stand here in front of him and not throw any punches. From now on, you got 2 rounds to go. I want to see you go to war. You understand me? Quit playing in the middle of the ring. All right? You're not going to outsmart him.
To win these 2 rounds.
I love a trainer who's honest with the fighter.
Yeah, I think Roger's doing a good job of telling him that. So he knows that he's losing the fight.
Combi box numbers in round 10, very much like every other round in the rest of the fight. Barrera 21 out of 63, Peden 8 out of 39. Robbie Peden comes out with devoted energy, trying to live up to what his trainer Roger Bloodworth wants him to do.
Well, he can be a very tough guy then if he comes out and fights, because he physically, like I said, and he's got those little movements and things that are a little distracting and confusing to some degree.
Is he trying to set up the leg? One big right hand?
Well, he doesn't punch that good to me, but he could still do enough to win these 2 rounds, be it possible. And I'll take that back. He could possibly score a knockout. He doesn't punch that bad, neither.
Knocked out Nate Campbell with one right hand.
Yeah. Well, once a guy sometimes, not even a big punch, he realizes he's beginning to land, he will concentrate and really tighten up and punch hard then.
More sharp, accurate punching from Marco Antonio Barrera. Landing a chopping right hand and a left hook, and now Peden scuffling with him. Trying to find a way to rough Barrera up inside. Barrera's got to make it through 5 more minutes without allowing that cut eye to become a competitive factor.
The Aussie fans in the background trying to rally Peden. Now, Peden came roaring out of the corner when the round started. And here he is dancing again.
And getting jabbed again.
He's more motion than he is punching.
Yeah.
I'm holding. Break. Break, listen up.
Barrera's enjoying this hitting on the break thing. He's landed 2 good clean shots that way. And as Larry Merchant said, why not? Good left hook to the body by Marco Antonio. Peden pawing upstairs with the left hand. Time slipping away. Sand passing through the hourglass. Robbie Peden still not making the big commitment that his trainer wants.
Great! Step back.
Solid right hand by Barrera knocks Peden back. Peden got himself into an off-balance position. You do that against a very accurate puncher like Marco, you're gonna get clocked. Barrera landed two big right hands in the last 10 seconds of the round to see the deal.
Okay, now you come out throwing everything with speed.
You got a round left, you better fight this whole round. Because you're walking up in front of him, you're holding your hands. You're
not this is the last and final round.
You have to take him. You have to knock him down. You have to knock him down. Let's go.
This is the last and final round.
You need to close real hard. Close the show.
Copy box numbers at 11. Barrera, 24 out of 70. Roger Bloodworth begged Robbie Peden to produce more offense, and Peden still threw only 46 punches. Throughout the fight, Barrera's been able to get off more. So now, as round 12 arrives, in all probability, it would seem that Peden needs a knockout.
And Barrera comes out, attacking from his boxing position. And so Peden, looking for a way to attack him, just can't find it.
And the crowd wonders why Robbie Peden doesn't want to risk more and commit more to try to win.
But when he does punch, if you watch the times when his punch output goes up, he actually starts winning for the most part still.
So Bloodworth's right.
Yeah, I've watched. He starts off the refs good, but then he cuts off. He's a lot of pretty defense motions and all of that, but very few effective output punches.
Great left hook to the body. Big right hand and a left hand upstairs.
Watching Barrera handle a guy who walked into the ring 13 pounds bigger. Does it give you any feeling about him if he were to fight Chavez? For a lightweight
Jesus
title?
Jesus Chavez, that is.
I don't know. I think if they did fight anyway, they would come in with a catch. But Chavez says he's normally 130 pounds anyway, so I always felt they would come in about 32 would be the agreement.
But do you think he can handle himself against a guy who is bigger, thicker, stronger than Peden?
Yes, I do.
Antonio's Barrera is having a huge 12th round. He just might get a chance to KO Robbie Peden anyway, after fighting a mostly technical boxing match all the way.
He's doing in the 12th round what Peden was supposed to do.
And that's what trainer Rudy Perez asked him for. I was amazed when Perez said, now come out and throw everything. But that's what Pereira's done, and effectively so.
But you notice Barrera shortens up his punches properly when he's in close range. Shoots him long when he's out of range, knows how to do everything perfect.
I think he's flawless, Emmanuel. He's just flawless.
I think he's a great fighter. Tonight, to me, was a big test. Even though it wasn't a big name, I knew this was going to be a very, very difficult opponent style-wise.
And right now, Marco Antonio Barrera is showing Robbie Peden, after years of the two of them sparring against each other, who's boss. He's saying, I am El Jefe.
And he did it the only way he could do it, systematically with a difficult opponent, but broken down. And now look at the short punches now in short range.
Tonight, Peden's going to get paid for the sparring. That's the only difference, as Barrera cruises the 61st victory of his brilliant career.
I am very impressed.
What a fighter.
He's a great fighter.
Packing most of the thrills into a 12th round finish, Marco Antonio Barrera once again makes an indelible statement.
He knows how to close the show, and in the twilight of his career. He looks like he wants to make it a very bright twilight.
Well, he told us yesterday, for reasons I haven't quite figured out, that he's going to fight 7 more fights. This was the first. There'll be 6 after this. Now, it's as though he pulled the number out of the air.
Yeah, this was a somewhat difficult opponent right here, because I've never saw him fight anyone like this here. And he closed the show. I always like to see a guy finish up not only landing more punches, which was a lot, I think.
51 out of 94 punches in the 12th round.
Fantastic.
It's a landslide, is what it is.
Very.
Let's take a look at the 3 judges who will be charged with this responsibility. Shouldn't be all that difficult for them. 54-year-old John Keane of England. He's one of the judges who had Eric Morales beating Jesus Chavez. Chavez won a big fight against Levander Johnson at the beginning of this card, and Keane scored that fight for Eric Morales. That was Chavez fighting against Morales with one arm here last year. Dave Moretti of the United States, the most recognizable of these 3 judges, had Morales beating Pacquiao 15-13 in 12 rounds. That, I believe, was the correct score in that fight. Morales won a unanimous decision. Michael Pernick is the least experienced, least known of these 3 judges, but he's gathering a resume of his own. Scored 115-113 for Zab Judah over DeMarcus Corley. Michael Buffer has the numbers. Let's hear him.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at the MGM Grand of Las Vegas, we go to the scorecards. Remember, the winner of this bout will be the unified WBC and IBF Super Featherweight World Champion. John Keane scores the contest 118-109. Michael Pernick and Dave Moretti both have it 118-108. All to the winner by unanimous decision. The Ciudad de Mexico, Marco Antonio Barrera.
And as